Hey, welcome back. My next guest is Thomas Achman, U.S. military veteran, U.S. Army, served in Afghanistan. Welcome, Tom.
Thanks.
So, Tom, delighted to have you here. Known you for a couple of years through your efforts over at Bridges, where you currently work. There's a lot of great things that Bridges is doing with vets through the Joseph P. Dwyer program, which our viewers are very familiar with. And we've had a number of vets that have been involved in the Dwyer program that have been on the show. Mm-hmm. And so we can talk a little bit about that. But before we kind of get to your work at Bridges, and in particular the program that is kicked off with the HITOR program, let's have our viewers get a little bit of a flavor of who you are. So maybe you can give a little bit about your background, where you were born, raised, and we'll talk a little bit about your service in Afghanistan.
Okay. I was born in Manhattan, raised in Orangeburg. I didn't join the military till I was 24. Mm-hmm. I wanted to kind of experience life for a little bit. I opened up a carpentry business, and the recession hit, and things weren't looking too good, so I needed a backup plan. Mm-hmm. Joined the Army. They said, we'll give you food, shelter, and we'll pay you. I said, right. Sign me up. And, mm-hmm. And sure enough, I ended up going to Afghanistan within a year of joining, and a very, very cold place. Got about 6 to 8 feet of snow and just in February alone.
Wow.
Rainy season. A lot of people think there's a lot of sand there. The spot I was in, I didn't see a speck of sand my entire time mm-hmm. there. I was in a place in RC East called, in Logar province, called Kurwar Valley. Mm-hmm. It was a bit of a safe haven for Taliban, and that's where they would come in from Pakistan, and they would hold up in there, and that's where I lived for about a year, from October to October. I was stationed out of Fort Polk, Louisiana, 10th mm-hmm. Mountain, 4th Brigade.
Okay. So, and how long were you in the Army altogether?
I was only in for 2 years.
2 years, okay. Sure. And then, so you were in Afghanistan for a year. What year were you in Afghanistan?
2010 to 2011, October okay. to October.
October. And so that must have been really an incredible experience. Now, I would imagine you experienced any combat over there?
Yeah, pretty decent amount of combat, yeah.
Maybe just give our viewers a flavor of some of the guys that you served with, and a little bit about that experience over in Afghanistan.
Well, I was field artillery. There were, 16 of us, maybe 10 of us living under one roof. We were all on the gun line. Bunch of good guys. We pulled a lot of guard. We did some artillery missions, but these were the guys that had my back. I had their back, right. And mm-hmm. It was it's not like you're going to battle alone. You you have someone to your left, someone to your right, mm-hmm. Someone watching your back. So
right.
it makes you feel a little safer, I guess.
Mm-hmm. So then you cycled out of the. You came home from Afghanistan and eventually cycled out of the out of service. Let's talk a little bit about your reintegration into out of the Army. I mean, I know from talking with you in the past and the Dwyer program in particular, it's a very difficult transition for our younger vets that are coming back, particularly those that have seen combat. And then they're coming back, having lived in a place like Afghanistan with not a lot of infrastructure and what have you. And then you're coming back, to your life before. So talk a little bit about what that was like, your reintegration back from the service back into the U.S.
It was terrible. I was very uncomfortable the entire time. I mean, when I got out, I was just very angry at everything. It was just strange being in a situation where people are encouraging you to kill or mm-hmm. encouraging you to tough it up and be by yourself, but also in, you know, reinforcing that there's strength in numbers, but mm-hmm. you know, do it yourself.
Right.
So there's a lot of conflict within when I got out, and I don't know. I've been to some pretty dark places. Managed to get out of them. Ended up reaching out for help at one point, and my friend Dana actually got me hooked up with the Dwyer program,
mm-hmm.
and after that things just kind of started taking off.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm on my way to being a nurse,
mm-hmm.
Which is total opposite end of what I was doing.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was a bumpy road, a very bumpy road.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've had to do a lot of self-care.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things for my mental health, physical health, spiritual health. I really it was not an easy transition.
Mm-hmm.
So when I see people getting out, I try to help them as best I can.
Right.
I have an idea of things that they might need, directions they might want to go.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people get out and they just kind of flounder. They,
mm-hmm.
they don't know what to do now because they're so used to having people telling them where to go, what to do,
mm-hmm.
and that's not the case when you're a civilian. It's like jumping into ice water. It's
mm-hmm.
You're just like in shock for a little bit, and then you start.
That's a great analogy.
Yeah.
Great analogy. You know, you've really. It's been impressive just to see how you've kind of moved forward, even in just the number of years that I've known a little bit about you. You know, obviously, Bridges was Rockland Independent Living Center. I had been the exec over there for about 5 years before I became supervisor, and the Dwyer program was a program that I was able to secure and bring over to the agency. It's really done some remarkable work, and I think you're the longest-serving employee of the Dwyer program. Maybe you could talk just a little bit about the Dwyer program. I know our viewers have heard about it in prior episodes with folks that have been involved with it, but let's talk a little bit about the Dwyer program, kind of what it does, and then let's talk about the newest program that you're doing with HITOR.
Okay. I think the Dwyer program kind of evolved into what it is today. When we started, it was we had some set goals. We were going to train mentors, and then we were going to pair up those mentors with veterans. And at first, it was very hard to find the veterans. And then slowly, it started trickling in,
mm-hmm.
and we kept training and training and training people. And I think we have over 100 mentors now mm-hmm. trained, and now we're in the Veterans Service Office.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like the floodgates opened, and there's just veterans left and right, veterans
mm-hmm.
in crisis all the time. And what the program does is it allows us to kind of, it's almost like a life coach for
mm-hmm.
veterans. It allows us to kind of keep tabs on them and make sure they're doing okay, make sure they're not in a bad space or homeless or
mm-hmm.
whatever the case, but it also helps us to encourage the veterans to do for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So if they have goals, but they just don't know where to start or what to do, sometimes we point them in the right direction.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they just need someone to talk to every now and then,
right.
You know. It's really, it varies from veteran to veteran. I mean, I had, just this past December, I had a veteran that was homeless. I was trying to find him a substance abuse treatment program on Christmas Eve.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was another one around New Year's Eve. He had a suicide attempt.
Mm-hmm.
So I had, I had two veterans in crisis that I was trying to square away, plus we have a whole slew of other veterans with other issues.
Mm-hmm.
Not to say that their issues are, you know, not important, but sometimes I have to triage.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and but that veteran that was homeless, he didn't spend a single night without a roof over his head, and both of them are actually coming out of treatment soon, and they seem to be doing pretty well.
That's great.
So
That's great, and that's a credit to you, the Veteran Service Agency, and to the Dwyer program, because it's that personal connection, you know. Because that was the other issue that I think that what makes the Dwyer program excel. You can have a lot of people that want to help, but you know, you experience combat. You're in the military, so you understand the mindset. You understand what people have gone through, and there's a common bond that takes place, whether it's guys that served in World War II, Korea, Vietnam, the Gulf War, Enduring Freedom, or any one of the other actions that you know, that have been named throughout the last 60 years. And so there's a common bond that takes place with folks that have served. Mm-hmm. And with people that haven't served, you know, there can be a sympathy, trying to be a connection, whatever it might be. But there's not that commonality from that shared experience, even if it's just different eras, different theaters of war, or different times. And everybody carries trauma. You know, we know this from just life in general. People carry trauma, and those that are coming from, you know, you're trained to go into the service, and you're trained to perform a mission, and it raises conflict, and there's trauma that and scars that people carry with them. But the Dwyer program really just shines because it brings those folks that have got that experience. And then there's a trust that can develop that isn't necessarily going to develop with others that didn't have that common experience, particularly those that need the assistance. And that's where that program really shines. So let's talk about the newest initiative that you're involved with HITOR, with service animals. And maybe you could speak to that for a minute or so.
Sure. As you know, we have every year we do the Americans with Disabilities Act breakfast. Mm-hmm. We had a trainer from HITOR who had just ended up on the board come in with a friend of his, and they both had service dogs. Mm-hmm. And I had been trying to get my service dog trained and having the hardest time getting and training. Well, I had the dog, but getting the training for the dog was near impossible. Mm-hmm. Either people wanted to charge incredible amounts of money, or just nobody wanted to do it. Mm-hmm. So I had him partially trained, and then when I met Frank and Doug, they said that they would help train him for free. Mm-hmm. And then once I started with that, I said, well, he said he would be willing to offer the training for dogs for veterans for free, and I said, well, why don't we get this off the ground? Mm-hmm. You know, I spoke with my bosses over at Bridges, and we set up a little bit of a program. We're going to be dealing with the administrative side of things, intakes, mm-hmm. and things like that. And Frank and HITOR, they're going to be taking care of pairing up the dogs, training the dogs, the whole fostering process. Mm-hmm. And we provide free service dogs for veterans. Currently, we have a dog training right now to sniff out hypo and hyperglycemia. Mm-hmm. We have a diabetic veteran. Right. We have a dog training for mobility issues, PTSD. I think we placed two dogs for PTSD already. Mm-hmm. They've helped train up my dog. He's under the table right now. Mm-hmm. You know. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a pretty great program. A lot of people, they need a dog, or they want a dog, but they don't know how to go about doing it. Mm-hmm. I help facilitate that a lot of the time. Unfortunately, sometimes they're not able to care for a dog. A lot of times, some of the veterans that need it the most are the ones that aren't fit to mm-hmm. care for a dog. But I mean, the two veterans I spoke about before, I believe, are going to be getting service dogs once they get out of treatment.
Oh, that's correct.
So, and they can be trained to do just about anything. Mm-hmm. And these are service dogs. They're not therapy animals. You can take them anywhere. You can bring them on a plane. Mm-hmm. You can bring mm-hmm. them in a hospital. And according to the ADA, there's almost nowhere you can't bring them, except for maybe a clean room, right. or an operating room, something like that. Mm-hmm. And so these dogs are here for support, you know, 24/7. You can train them for whatever, mobility issues, if you have diabetes, if you have memory loss, things like that, if you have a traumatic brain injury, you need to take medicine, you can put a little alarm around the dog's collar, and it'll when it goes off, it'll go get the medicine and bring it to you. It could be just about anything. If we can think of a way to train the dog, we'll do it.
That's great. And it's just a great program to get the shelter involved with dogs that are essentially homeless, and try and get them, trained up so that they can help our vets who have given so much to us. So, you know, Tom, it's I'm just so impressed with where you've kind of brought your career and how you've kind of redefined yourself and where you're moving. And I know that you're now we're looking at, you had said earlier, unfortunately, you're going to be moving on from eventually from Bridges down to the VA, you know, later this year. But I know that you'll continue with some of your volunteerism with Bridges, most likely, and with the vets up here. But I want to thank you for your service to our country, but just as importantly, your service to vets through the Bridges program and through the Veterans Service Agency. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you for being such a great guest.
Appreciate it.
So coming up, Clarkstown Animal Control Officer Pat Coleman. Stay tuned.